السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to Reflections. I'm your host, Imam Suhaib Webb. Reflections is a show designed to just make us do that, reflect. But reflect requires an object. So the question arises, what is the object of our reflection for this show? What is it that we're going to reflect on over the next few episodes? And that is the greatest gift ever sent to humanity. Through the agency of the greatest human being ever sent to humanity. We're going to reflect on the Quran, which was brought to us by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ask yourself, when you receive a package or an email, if it just comes to you as a normal package or a normal email, do you really pay it much attention? But if someone sends something to you first class, or someone sends something to you that requires your signature, you're bound to open it, you're bound to read it, you're bound to ponder on it, you're bound to reflect on it. What about the Quran that was sent to the greatest human being ever, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, who, when Angel Gabriel met him, said, Wallahi, he said, by Allah, I have traversed the entire globe and I have never met anyone more honorable than you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed before each and every one of us a gift. The word hidayah comes from the same word as hadiyah, as gift, because guidance is a gift from Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this software bungle, this package, if you will, of guidance in His book called the Quran. This show, Reflections, is designed to help us develop a greater intimacy with the Quran, to make tafakkur of Quran. Because the ulama said that before tadhakkur, there has to be tafakkur. That before someone can recall and remember something, they have to ponder on it and understand its existence first. So first and foremost, we want to develop this intimacy with the Qur'an, to familiarize ourselves with the Qur'an. As though we're sitting in a coffee shop and the Qur'an is sitting in front of us. As though we're sitting in a coffee shop and the Qur'an is sitting in front of us. As though we're on the train and the Qur'an sits next to us. As though we're chatting online and we find that we're chatting with the Qur'an. This show presents a unique opportunity for us to get to know intimately the Qur'an. Just like when we go shopping and look at shoes and clothing and computers and specs, now we're going to take a deep analysis of the Qur'an in order to gain this tafakkur. And Allah says about the Qur'an that if the Qur'an was sent on a mountain, you would see the mountain crumble. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. Allah says that if the Quran was sent upon a mountain, you would see the mountain crumble. Imam al-Qurtubi said, if that's the mountain, then what about the hearts of the people if they ponder on the Quran? All of the ego, all of the evil, all of the vice, all of the insecurity, all of the arrogance, all of the falsehood will crumble away from the Quran, and all of that will crumble from the heart, and all that's left will be pure fitrah. So this is a show which we want to begin to interview, to engage, to develop, to love, to cry, to laugh, to celebrate with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Quran, in a way in which we've never done before. And Allah says about the Quran, وَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. With this Quran, celebrate the praises of Allah, because it's better than anything you could ever have. And that's why tafakkur, pondering and reflecting, comes before tadhakkur, remembering. Because they say tafakkur qabla al-wujud, that when you ponder on something, that's prior to you understanding its existence. And tadhakkur, remembering that thing, comes after you've understood it. Either you remember it in a good way or a bad way. And that's why in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never says, فَأْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never says for us to ponder Allah abundantly, but He says, فَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Remember Allah abundantly, because all of us know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of us have lived our lives experiencing His blessings. But what about the Quran? What about the Quran? So this show, Reflections, is a show which is designed to empower us to be able to reflect and develop this relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that we can become from those people who have tafakkur to those people who have tadhakkur, who remember the great blessings, bounties, and mercies of the Quran. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, He encouraged us to engage the Quran. How many of you, if someone said, if you come to Protonas Towers tomorrow, you'll be the greatest person? If someone said, if you go to an Usher concert tomorrow, you'll be the greatest person? If someone said, if you dress like Beyonce tomorrow, you'll be the greatest person? All of us, unfortunately, might run after that kind of stuff. But what did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you are those who learn and teach the Quran to others. This is an invitation from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam to be from the best people. It's not difficult. It's not hard. It just requires a little bit of an investment in understanding, engaging the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about which the Prophet said, اقرأوا القرآن. The Prophet said, recite the Quran. فَإِنَّهُ يَأْتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Because the Quran will come on the last day as an intercessor for you. Is Usher going to intercede for you? Is Harry Potter going to intercede for you? Is Beyonce going to intercede for you? Is anything of this dunya going to intercede for you when you face Allah? Only the Quran. So this is a great opportunity for us to develop this relationship with the Quran. We look forward to seeing you soon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The reason that I say salam to you again is that the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if they passed by a stone, they would say salam to each other after going around the stone. So now we've come back from commercial breaks, so we should begin by saying assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, if you had not seen a good friend of yours for a number of months, if you had not seen a close friend, how would you feel? Surely you would feel sad. Let's ask ourselves, who was the best friend of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira? After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who was it that was there for the Prophet when he was down? Who was there that strengthened the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam when he faced all the opposition that he had to deal with? Who was it that strengthened his sense of ethics even at the moment of victory? It was the Quran. And we have an incredible example from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he missed the Quran. He longed for the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Surah Al-Duha, and we'll talk about this in some coming episodes insha'Allah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he sent this chapter to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a 2-week break of revelation, and the Prophet became saddened. And many ulama say that he was saddened because he longed for the Quran. When was the last time we opened up the Quran, looked at its majestic pages, looked at its beautiful letters, thought about its incredible meanings? Do we long for the Quran? Do we cry when we miss the Quran? Do we cry when we miss reading the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam? Insha'Allah, we're going to start reflecting on the Quran. We can become the people who move from tafakkur to tadhakkur. And after tadhakkur comes shukr. We can move from being reflective to remembering and then being thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the Quran. The Quran is a beautiful book, and it comes from a word qara'a. And the scholars, it's totally incredible. It's really too cool for words. As I tell people all the time, Islam is too cool for Muslims. Islam is just too cool for us. We always have to, you know, mess around with it. We have to make it a little bit strict or a little bit liberal, but we should leave Islam the way it is because it's just too cool for us. The word Quran comes from the word qara'a, qara'a. And the ulama differed. Some of them said that the word qara'a means to join together, to join together, to bring things together. Other ulama said that qara'a means to recite, to recite. Those who said that the Quran means to bring things together, they said, for example, the word in Arabic al-qarya, which means village, because people come together in the kampong, in the village. So they said also Quran because it brings letters and words together. The majority of ulama said, no, the Quran means to recite. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. When we talk about the Sharia, Islamic definition of Quran, we say this is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sent to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whose recitation is an act of ibadah, meaning the only book we can pray with is the Quran. We cannot even pray with hadith. Nobody can say, Allahu Akbar an Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu qal. The only book we're authorized to pray with is the Quran. The Quran is our license to pray, to draw nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He revealed it to Muhammad, He made its act mutaabbad bi tilawatihi, reading the Quran as an act of worship, who begins with Surah Al-Fatiha and ends with Surah Al-Nas, is in the beautiful Arabic language, Sintu khayr al-khalqi Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the Quran. If you're sitting in a coffee shop and you're introducing yourself, I'm such and such from Shah Alam, I'm such and such from Kelantan, I'm such and such from KL, I'm such and such from Ampang, the Quran will say, I'm such and such from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sent to be your anchor and support and your GPS to Jannah. This is the Quran. So we're talking about the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gaining this reflection and understanding of the Quran. There's a few points that we should address. Number one, how do we think about the Quran? I remember once I was in a Muslim country and I was reading the Quran in front of someone's house because alhamdulillah, I was blessed to memorize the Quran and I finished my memorization in Mecca. So I remember I was reviewing the Quran in front of someone's home and suddenly the phone started ringing and people were calling saying, is everything okay? Has someone died? Is someone wounded? Has some type of catastrophe befallen you? And they asked them why. They said, because there's a big white man in front of your house reading the Quran. Why else would a big white dude be in front of your house reading the Quran? Obviously something crazy happened. This is the first problem that we have. The only time we relate to the Quran is when disaster strikes. The only time we relate to the Quran is when something crazy happens. And that's why usually when someone dies, which is wonderful, we read the Quran. But we don't read the Quran to die. We read the Quran to live. Many people say they want to die for Islam. Where are those people who say they want to live for Islam? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Quran, لِيُنذِرَ مَنْ كَانَ حَيًّا. The Quran was sent to the living, those who are alive, those who are living. So number one, we have to eschew reading the Quran only when bad things happen, but also when good things happen. Secondly, how we were taught the Quran. I remember once in America, I was teaching a very, very wonderful, intelligent girl from a Muslim country, and she was memorizing the Quran with me, and she was just an incredibly intelligent young woman. And then one day she made a mistake, and I gave her a piece of candy. And she said, Sheikh, Sheikh, you're not gonna hit me? And I said, why would I hit you? She said, because all the teachers of Quran, they hit us. As though the job of people who teach the Quran is to hit children. If we hit people to teach them the Quran when they're young, we're gonna have to hit them again to teach them the Quran when they're older. But the opposite, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the best advertiser of the truth. The best advertisement that Allah could send was the Prophet. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he said things about Quran that caused people to flee to it. He said, لِكُلِّ حَرْفٍ عَشَرُ حَسَنَاتٍ. Every letter from the Quran you read, you get 10 hasanat. And what that means is, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ قَافْ لَمْ is 20 hasanat. But in actuality, it's more because qaf is qaf, alif, fa, qaf. So when you say qul, that's 30 hasanat. Lam is lam, alif, meem. So this is three letters. So actually qul is 30, 30. So qul by itself is 60 hasanat. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we finish now this segment, he said, Ahlullah, Ahlul Quran. How many of you would want to be the people of Allah? How many of us want to be the people of Allah? The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the people of Allah are the people of Quran. We are going to return shortly after this commercial break and continue our discussion on the Quran. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Uthman radiallahu anhu was asked, how can I be near to Allah? He responded, I know of no other way faster than His words.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to Reflection. I'm your host, Imam Suhaib Webb. We've been talking about the most important intimate thing in our life after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Quran. A few things that we should understand as we sit at this coffee table with the Quran and the Quran introduces itself to us. The scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, the scholars of Islamic philosophy, noted that the Quran is a book of kulliyat, that the Quran is a book of universal principles which guide our life. In some cases, these universals were explained by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is the mufassir of Quran, the explainer of Quran. In other instances, many of these kulliyat were explained by the great ulama like Imam Abu Hanifa, like Imam Malik, like Imam Shafi'i, and like Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhum jami'an. And the Quran is a book of kulliyat because it empowers the Quran to be an everlasting miracle. We hear about that all the time. The Quran is an everlasting miracle. The Quran is an everlasting miracle. The Quran is an everlasting miracle. But we should ask, what does that mean? What does that statement mean? So let's take a quick trip through that so that I can explain to you what it means when we say that the Quran is an everlasting miracle and that the Quran is based on these huge, massive universals which encompass every culture, every lifestyle, every human being, so that the Quran becomes a book not only for the Arabs, but a Quran becomes a book for humanity sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First, the Quran encourages us to respect and honor culture. One of the greatest misunderstandings that people have is that Islam comes to replace culture. We have this term now over the last 15 years, the cultural wars. But the Quran teaches us something very different. The Quran teaches us to respect culture. In the Quran, Allah says, "Wa'mur bil 'urf." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to respect culture. And in the Quran, most of the daily actions and practices of the people outside of worship are left open. For example, Allah says in the Quran, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, which means live with your wives in the best way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say in the fourth chapter of the Quran, if you love your wife, go and buy her chocolate. Can you imagine in the Quran if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you love your wife, فَاشْتَرِي لَهَا chocolate, go and buy her some chocolate. But what if your wife is allergic to chocolate? Or what if the Quran ordered you to buy dairy products and your wife had lactose intolerance? But the Quran left it open. What he said, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, live with your wives in a good way. Meaning according to the custom that you live, according to the society that you live in, make your wives feel good and respected. It did not regulate it to some cultural Arab phenomena, but left it open. And that's why the Malikiyya, we say, al-urfu kash-shart, that the custom of the people is like a condition in Islamic law. Number two, the Quran encourages us to deal with people differently. One of the biggest mistakes we find amongst Muslim activists and workers is this tendency to be brittle, harsh, and rough on everyone they meet. And as Imam Ibn Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, the great Hanbali Ash'ari scholar, he noted that the person who is always brittle and harsh on others, thinking that they're on the truth, is the one who needs the truth more than anyone else. The one who, because of the truth, they treat others with insolence is usually the one who needs the medication the most, the medication of the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran encourages us as parents, we should not always compare our children to each other. Oh, you're not like your big sister, or you're not like your little brother, or you're not like this or that. That's very, very unfortunate that we do that. And that's a way to really break the child. We should not treat each other in the same way, but we should respect differences in the realities of people. We find this in the 49th chapter of the Quran. Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu are some of the greatest companions. They are the greatest companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And Abu Bakr and Umar, one day they raised their voices in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, لا ترفعوا أصواتكم فوق صوت النبي. Don't raise your voices above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah said that if you don't stop this, أن تحبط أعمالكم وأنتم لا تشعرون, that your deeds will be cancelled. When this verse came, Umar was so frightened that he, from that point onward, used to say, Ya Rasulallah, Ya Rasulallah. He would whisper the name of the Prophet ﷺ. But in the same chapter, we find a group of Bedouins, simple Arabs from the hood, Arabs from the ghetto, coming to the Prophet ﷺ. Ya Muhammad, Ya Muhammad, Ya Muhammad, raising their voices in front of the Prophet ﷺ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not correct these crazy Arabs, these crazy Bakwal Bedouins from the hood, in the same way that he corrected Umar and Abu Bakr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to these Arabs, Wallahu ghafoorur rahim. Allah is forgiving, most merciful. Why would Allah say to Abu Bakr and Umar, your deeds are going to be canceled for raising your voices? Why would he say to these Arabs that what? Your Allah is most forgiving, most merciful? Because these are two very different types of people. Another thing that we learn from the Quran is that every amal has to have an adab. I tell people all the time that amal is the body and the adab is the clothing. Amal is the body and adab is the zina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to pray, but He ordered us to pray with khushu. Allah ordered us to give sadaqah, but not to do so in an arrogant way. So we learn from the Quran not to divorce adab from amal. Qawlun ma'rufun. وَصَدَقَةٌ Allah says, good words, قَوْلٌ مَعْرُوفٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ يَتْبَعُهَا أَذَى Allah says that a good word which is followed with good treatment is better than sadaqah that you give to someone like this and you look down upon them. So we cannot divorce amal from adab. When people divorce amal from adab, worship from ethics, there's a problem in their iman. So the Quran gives us these universal principles. This is our show, Reflecting on the Quran. Our next episode, we plan to talk about Surat Al-Fatiha and begin this gateway with the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless each and every one of you for watching our show. Jazakum Allahu khairan. We hope you will tune in next time. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.